Good evening, buonasera. My name is Anthony Tamburri, and I'm Dean of the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute, and I want to welcome you on this rainy night. Some of you may have seen the entire film, Panne, amaro. There is actually not a sequel, but there is the counterpart of the West Coast, because if you haven't seen Panne, amaro, it deals basically predominantly with the Northeast or the East Coast, actually, not the Northeast, but the East Coast, east of the Mississippi, and also from about 1885 to about 1942, 43. And then what our two friends, filmmakers, did was they went west, and they did one also on Italians in California, and it's wonderful to see the difference in the experience, what happened here on the East Coast, what happened on the West Coast, and so on and so forth. So all that to say that both films are available here, and you can see Gianfranco later at the end of the evening. But we were chatting, Gianfranco and I. This is a film that I've followed for a few years, and so I just thought it'd be good if, because the film is so well divided up, that it's wonderful for teaching, those of us who have used it for teaching. It's wonderful for teaching because you can actually use bits and pieces of it in different parts of your course. You don't have to show the whole thing if you don't want to, but you can show the whole thing as well. And so we were chatting, and I just thought it'd be great if we invited a couple of our scholar friends who deal with the issues, some of the themes, and that we could probably revisit them on a sequential or sectional basis. So we finally decided that we would do that. I'm not going to give big introductions to anybody. We are who we are because of we're here tonight. What we did, and we're proud of what we did, but we count for what we're going to say tonight. I want to give you just a minute or two, if you want, Gianfranco, to say something, and then we're going to look at the first part, and then Gianfranco and I will sort of talk about the first part that deals with Italians and lynching, and then we're going to move on to two other parts, and our two professor friends will deal with those, and I'll introduce them by their names when they come up here. So, Gianfranco, you want to?
Thank you for coming. I'll just say a few words. To say that, first of all, this film, I made this film with Suma, Kurien, my wife, co-producer, partner in crime, and various other things. And perhaps later we can talk together also with Suma about some of these points that we tried to deal with in the film. Just a few words about how the film came about. We have made this film for the Italian television, RAI. There are some Italians here, and they know it's the Italian national TV. And it was made for a program called La Grande Storia. And we'll talk about that in the conversation later, also to see how it was received in Italy. But the important thing for us was to basically examine the fact that in Italy there had been a kind of amnesia when it came to the experience of the emigranti. And the reason was that, Italy started experiencing immigration in the country itself in the early years 2000, which is when we made the film. And Italians were not dealing very well with the immigrants at all. The tensions escalated, and you can see today the tensions are really very palpable, and the political situation has been changed also as a consequence of these tensions against immigration. I'll leave it at that, and we'll just talk about after the first chapter. This first chapter is about 10 minutes, and then we will talk about it. Thank you.
Thirty-nine Italian immigrants are victims of lynchings across the United States between 1886 and 1916. This photograph, taken in September 1910, shows the lynching of two Italians in Tampa, Florida. The next day, it appears on hundreds of postcards. The largest lynching in the history of the United States takes place in New Orleans in 1891 and involves the murder of 11 Italian immigrants.
Lynching was a form of murder, a form of punishment that was directed overwhelmingly at African Americans. So I think that the fact that you have these number of instances of Italians being lynched in the late 19th, early 20th century, I think speaks to the racial component, the fact that they were seen as not quite white, or what some historians have described as in between white and black.
By the end of the 1800s, New Orleans is one of the most prosperous cities in the United States. Through its port, pass most of the agricultural goods produced in the south of the country. It is also the point of entry for imports from South America and Europe. The city has close commercial ties, particularly with Sicily, where it buys lemons and oranges. New Orleans is also the center of the cotton and sugarcane industries, both based on the work of African Americans. When slavery is abolished, many blacks leave the plantations. To replace them, American employers recruit thousands of Italians, especially Sicilians, ready to do jobs that no white Americans are willing to do.
There were tens of thousands of Italians living in New Orleans, a sizable population, many of whom have been recruited to work in agriculture, in agricultural communities. And it has been speculated that one of the reasons why they were aroused so much hostility, it was partly the idea of obviously crime syndicates, but also that they lived often in close proximity with black Americans, worked with black Americans, and so they were not clearly separating themselves from black Americans, and this aroused a lot of hostility on the part of white Americans. The arguments that were made for recruiting Italians are interesting because they basically indicate that they would make better Negroes than the Negroes, that they would work harder, and that they were of a higher caliber of people, and that they would displace black workers. And that makes them both desired and undesirable at the same time.
Most of the Italian immigrants live in the poorest areas of the city. They continue many of the customs and traditions of the rural communities from which they come, and often live in the same neighborhoods as blacks. By living and working near African Americans, the Italians break a rule that regulates life in the American South at the time, the strict separation between the races. By the 1890s, the Italian community in New Orleans has grown to more than 30,000. Along with the farm workers, there are also artisans, fishermen, and merchants who begin to immigrate from Sicily. They work hard, and in a few years become established in the trade of fruit, fish, and oysters. The Italians' growing numbers and their commercial success caused some resentment, as seen in a report by the office of the mayor, Joseph Shakespeare. The report describes the Italians as filthy in their persons and coming from the worst classes of Europe, and adds they don't learn our language and monopolize the trade of fish, fruit, and oysters. Meanwhile, the newspapers of New Orleans are warning the city about a bloody feud between two gangs of Sicilian longshoremen. The chief of police, David Hennessy, is responsible for investigating it. On the night of the 11th of February, 1891, Hennessy is ambushed. He is alone and is hit by 12 bullets fired from sawed-off shotguns. Hennessy fires back, but is overwhelmed. The assassins disappear in the dark. Before dying, the chief of police manages to say a few words to his rescuers, that Dago's got me. Dago is already the most common derogatory term in America for the Italian immigrant. The mayor of New Orleans declares the killing the work of the mafia. He orders mass arrests in the Italian neighborhoods. 150 Italian immigrants are picked up and interrogated. The eyes of all America are on New Orleans. 9 Italians are put on trial. For many, the verdict comes as a shock. All of the defendants are found innocent for lack of evidence. However, they are not freed from prison.
For the American citizens of New Orleans, the acquittal of the Italians was a miscarriage of justice. And so they decided then that it was necessary to take justice into their own hands when the court system had failed them. And a mob of several thousand citizens was incited to violence.
The day after the 9 Italians are acquitted, an announcement appears in the main newspapers of New Orleans. It is signed by the most prominent citizens of the city and summons the public to a mass meeting. A prominent New Orleans lawyer, William Parkerson, speaks to the gathered crowd.
When courts fail, the people must act. What protection is there left us when the very head of our police is assassinated by the mafia, and his assassins are again turned loose on the community? Will every man here follow me and see the murder of Chief Hennessy vindicated?
A crowd of 10,000 attacks the main prison of New Orleans. With the help of the prison warden, all the Italian inmates are identified. The prisoners plead in vain for mercy. Nine are killed in a hail of gunfire. Two are hanged in front of the prison.
The response to this from the citizens of New Orleans was relief. You know, they had done their patriotic duty. The response from Americans around the country was similar, that there was the threat of organized crime in New Orleans and that the lynching had shown Italians in New Orleans and around the country that this threat would not be taken lightly and that the mafia would not be permitted to take root and flower here as it had done in Italy.
In total, 39 Italian immigrants are lynched all across the United States. Between 1882 and 1951, there are a total of 4,730 recorded victims of lynchings. More than 70% are African Americans. The others include Italians, Mexicans, Native Americans, Chinese, and one Jew.
Although lynching was primarily a form of punishment that was doled out to African Americans, lynching was a way of disciplining people who were perceived to be outside the boundaries of civilization. So African Americans, Italian Americans, whenever they would do something that suggested that they were not keeping in their place, this would be used as a form of discipline, a public violent form of discipline, to demonstrate to members of the dominant group that they were still in control.
What I wanted to point out, you mentioned that about immigration, and there's obviously a racial issue here, right, underlying this whole historical event, right? And I was always tickled by the title of Gian Antonio Stella's book, Lorda, quando gli albanesi eravamo noi. And for those of you who don't know Italian, Lorda means the horde, when we were the Albanese, because immigration, the sort of invasion started early in around the 70s, 60s or 70s with the Albanese. However, by the time the book was published, there had already been a racial issue. And I was just always sort of perplexed by that subtitle at that late date. And that the subtitle could have been something different, I thought, just because of this history here and what we see also, what's been going on in Italy, because we had as early as 1990 with the film by Michele Placido, Pomaro, which is a story about the Senegalese who picks tomatoes. So anyway, that just a way to contextualize the issue and this issue of race and immigration was an issue here in the 1890s and tends to be an issue also in Italy. And I want to bring it to Italy because I think it's part of our duty to bring it back to Italy today, because we are, those of us who are Italian-American and whose grandparents have experienced this and whose parents have experienced some of this, we need to make sure that that conversation happens. So that's how I'm opening up with this.
Okay, so as I was saying, we started thinking about making a film about this subject, this experience, when we realized that Italians were not dealing well with the immigration that they were, for the first time, receiving in large numbers. We realized that there had not been many documentaries or kind of books that were specific on this experience. And we proposed it to the Italian television. They agreed in fact, provided funding for the filming. But when it came the time to broadcast it, it turned out that it was a bit of a difficult subject. And instead of going on the air at 9 p.m., it went on the air at 11 p.m. So the reviews were very good. The La Stampa, an important paper in Italy, reviewed the film and said that the film should be shown in elementary schools and high schools everywhere in Italy, because this is a history that has been forgotten, and that it's important that kids start learning about this. And it's really outrageous that the Italian national television put it on the air at 11 p.m. It is obviously kind of a difficult subject, especially starting with the lynchings. We chose to start with the lynchings because we thought that it was important that we make clear from the beginning that this was not another celebratory film about the Italian-American experience. Is not the Zio d'America, the uncle from America, who becomes enormously successful, helps the family. It's all a rosy picture. We wanted to show the discrimination, the pain, the violence that they experience. So that's how it started. And then it was broadcast other times, but always in odd hours. So we had a collection of 8 a.m., 3 a.m., 5 p.m. So
now the Italian version was an hour? It was short?
It was
2 hours?
104 minutes.
104 minutes? Okay.
As long as this.
Obviously, as we, once we made the film in Italian, we also realized this amnesia was not just on the other side of the ocean. This amnesia about the Italian-American history was also something that Italian-Americans suffered from, or rather a selective amnesia, so that there were parts of this history that people either did not remember, chose not to remember, and so it seemed to us important to talk about parts of the story that people don't know, also because we thought that this is useful history, that this still has relevance to today in all kinds of obvious ways. It's interesting, here we talk about Italians being not seen as quite white. We showed it a few years ago. We were invited to show it at a Jesuit college in New Jersey, I don't remember the name anymore, by an African-American faculty member. We showed it, and at the end of it, an Italian-American professor got up to say, "You know, the last time I looked in the mirror, I was white." He was just absolutely offended that anybody would have considered Italian Americans as being anything other than white. But we know that that is not the story, that is not the history, and that has continued to be, you know, and we've had people, you know, tell us all kinds of anecdotes about what this has meant in their lives for them and their life experiences. You know, something else that kind of continues, I think, to reverberate is the relationship between the proximity here, and Marianne talks about having lived with African Americans, having taken the jobs of enslaved African Americans as they came in to New Orleans, continuing to live with them and not being seen as quite different or separate from them, both was a complicating thing for them, and I think has continued to kind of be a complicated relationship for Italian Americans and African Americans throughout the history. And that, yeah, too, is something that continues to reverberate.
Exactly. Yeah. And also around this time, end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, there would be job postings, and it would say, no coloreds or Italians need apply. And so Italians and blacks would be lumped together in as undesirables, as I think you, I don't know if you used that term, yeah, somebody used that term, undesirable. And so, and yet Italian Americans haven't, don't, as you said, aren't aware of that history. It's been, pun intended, it's been whitewashed, basically. Yeah. And so we still don't have, in all with the plethora of studies that have come out in the last 30, 35 years on Italian American history, culture, literature, cinema, and so on and so forth, we still don't have a prime. There are tons of books that you can read with tons of footnotes and tons of complicated, perhaps sometimes too complex, phraseology of the author, the scholar, yet we still don't have a nice little primer on the history of Italians in America. We don't have that 150 or 200 page book that just sort of gives you an idea of what it's all about. There are a number of popular histories over the years that have been written by some really top-notch scholars, political scientists. I'm thinking of De Conde, Bittersweet, something bittersweet. Something like that. His book is about 500 pages, but we don't have that little book that would invite one to read about the history of the Italians in America. We have the film, which is good. Let's watch the second chapter.
So I would go to the lady's house on the avenue and pick up all the wool for them, and they all would sit in. It was summertime. They would sit in the hallway because it was all tile. There was a window. They all would be crocheting hats.
At the beginning of the 1900s, the garment industry is the largest economic activity in New York City and employs more than 150,000 women. Almost all of the workers are immigrants, primarily Eastern European Jews and Southern Italians. Over the years, the Italians become the majority.
When the Italian immigrants started coming here in about 1880, the men, of course, were looking for laborer jobs. My grandfather in particular, in Italy, was a bootmaker. But when he came to this country, there wasn't much to do for bootmakers. And he became a shoemaker, and the women in the family had to go to work. And the only work that was available to them was operators, sewing machine operators.
The garment industry in New York City consists of hundreds of sweatshops, where most of the work is piecework. The conditions are poor and often exploitative. The factories are small, with an average of 20 workers, and compete against each other, constantly lowering the salaries. The largest of these is a new factory for women's blouses. It employs 500 workers and uses the latest technology. It is called the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory and is located in Greenwich Village.
The Triangle factory was more modern than most. And one of the ways that this played itself out was all of the machines, all of the sewing machines and all of the various other machines were powered uniformly, by a drive shaft that went underneath the tables, which meant that the factory owners could control to some degree the speed of production. These were immigrant workers who had a developing sense of English, and their inability to communicate at work was really something that Triangle enforced. I mean, Triangle was desperately fearful that workers who, once they started talking to each other, would start to organize. So workers were forbidden to talk to the worker next to them. The idea was if you were talking to your neighbor, then you weren't working hard enough or fast enough.
The conditions of work in New York's sweatshops drive the women workers to form a union. And in 1909, thousands join together in a general strike. It will be known as the Uprising of the 20,000 and is the largest strike of women workers in American history. The strike succeeds thanks to the support of middle-class women who walk the picket lines and get arrested along with the workers, generating wide publicity. Working conditions and salaries improve, if only temporarily. The Triangle factory is one of the few places where the strike fails.
The Triangle Shirtwaist Company was probably one of the most anti-union concerns in the industry. They hired known convicts that were released on parole. They hired prostitutes to rough up the strikers and the picketers on the line. They, at least on several occasions, but one known occasion, essentially put a contract out on one of the strike leaders, and the woman was beat up pretty badly and hospitalized for a few days.
Three women of the Maltese family all work at the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory.
My grandmother went to work for Triangle, which was the big employer on the Lower East Side at that time. And then as my aunt, Lucia, came of age, she went to work there. And then my other aunt, Rosaria, worked there. The younger girls, they had to keep the operators supplied with clothes to sew so that there was no downtime. Then as Rosaria became more immersed in the business, she became an operator and worked probably part-time as an operator and then as a floor girl and then keep going up until she became an operator too. And her age was 14. My aunt Lucia was 18 and my grandmother was 38. And they were all operators on the eighth floor of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory.
For years, the owners of Triangle succeed in keeping unions out of their factory.
Doors were locked because the Triangle factory did not want union activists coming in. They didn't want workers, quote unquote, taking goods out. They wanted to control the space of their factory and have workers come and go under the watchful eye of their managers.
On March 25th, 1911, a mild Saturday afternoon, Caterina, Lucia, and Rosaria Maltese are working at their sewing machines on the eighth floor. With them are 170 other women workers.
The fire started on the eighth floor on the green street windows, and the fire rushed very rapidly to the ninth floor. By the time the flames reached the ninth floor, all the exits had been sealed off. One door was chained shut, no one had the key. The second staircase had essentially exploded in flames. Two fire companies were called out. By the time the hook and ladder arrived, workers were faced with a terrible choice. The flames from the eighth floor had engulfed most of the ninth floor. More than half the workers could not get out. Workers tried to save themselves by jumping out the window because firemen had opened up nets, life-saving nets. The firemen tried everything they could to save these workers, but the reality was someone jumping out of a window nine floors up crashed right through the nets.
My grandfather found out about the fire through the neighborhood grapevine. People were there, and for some reason it spread within the hour that there was a terrible fire at Triangle. Anybody that had family or friends went to the Triangle site. They were there looking to see what bodies they could identify right there.
What you had on this street right here, as crowds gathered around here watching the inferno, was the sight of sheer helplessness. Here was the greatest city in the United States at the time, the most modern fire department, and here were 146 people, mostly young women, almost all immigrants, dying in front of the eyes of predominantly middle-class residents. Washington Square Park, a block away from where the factory is located, is essentially a middle-class area. So you have middle-class residents of the city seeing smoke, hearing disturbances, rushing to the scene, thinking that the fire department will save these workers, and watching as all these workers jump to their death, and there's little that anyone could do.
The whole east side at the time had somebody in the Triangle fire. Either it was an aunt, a sister, a friend, a cousin. There were approximately 500 to 600 people that worked at Triangle. So you figure that in necessity, there must have been 450 immediate families stretched out to cousins. It hit the whole east side. My grandfather went immediately to identify the three, and he identified quickly my Aunt Lucia and my Aunt Rosaria. He was unable to identify my grandmother. But every day before he went to work, he would go to the morgue, and they had the belongings of each body. They might have had a piece of cloth, or a hair ribbon, or possibly a wedding ring. After going to the morgue every day for a year, my grandfather finally made a decision that this box was hers. And it was one of the seven bodies that was buried in Evergreen Cemetery as unidentified. He had her disinterred and brought to Calvary Cemetery, and she was put in a family plot. The funerals were going on for days. In those days, they had what they call funeral processions. The crowds packed streets around the funeral procession. And I don't think anybody wasn't touched by what happened. The family was cut in half. My grandfather was left with two sons and no female influence in the house. I don't understand how he was able to carry on.
One of the witnesses to the Triangle fire is Frances Perkins. She becomes a champion for safe working conditions and is appointed Secretary of Labor by President Roosevelt in 1933. Legislation that she helped pass still protects factory workers today. Every year on March 25th, New York City honors the memory of the 146 immigrants who died in the Triangle Fire. The names of the victims are read by members of the Textile Workers Union, who are also today mostly immigrants.
Salafia Salafio.
Vincenza Bellotta.
Anna Ardito.
Caterina Montese. Lucia Montese. Rosario Montese.
Mary Ann Trasciatti is a professor of rhetoric and communication at Hofstra University, and among her work on Italian-American or in Italian-American studies is a book on Sacco and Vanzetti, another theme we perhaps need one of these, we need to explore one of these evenings. Let me start out with a bit of a provocative question. How come we don't have a monument to this, but we do to everybody else?
Actually, there are plans underway to build a monument to this. Stay tuned. I rumor has it that an application is being presented to the Landmarks Preservation Commission in the very near future to give permission to build a monument on this landmarked building.
And let me just say, it's sort of an inside joke, that question. A while back, we had an evening here of talking about monuments, and we discussed Christopher Columbus, the Italo Balbo Monument in Chicago, and the monument that has yet to exist, which is the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. And there is actually, and later, if you want to talk about it, there is an entire project, and there's some funding from the state and things of that sort. So, but I do seriously want to make sort of underscore that the fact that this is a tragic event within the history of both Italian Americans and Jewish Americans, because, and correct me if I'm wrong, the 140 some odd people who died were more or less evenly divided, right?
It was about a third were Italians.
A third.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, but yet somehow we don't know about that within our community. And I won't mention names, of course, you know, si dice il peccato, non il peccatore, but I mentioned this to a self-proclaimed leader a few months ago, that there was this campaign for the monument, and the person asked me what the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory was. So,
yeah, so thank you for that. Thank you also, Gianfranco and Suma. It's really nice to see you both again and to see parts of the film. And I remember fondly working with you in the New York Public Library for many hours filming. So Anthony, that's actually what I was just going to throw out a few comments about history and memory. And I'm not quite sure I know that people have written. I mean, lots of ink has been spilled on this, and I'm not quite sure where history bleeds into memory, but there are a few things I think that bear saying. First is that, of course, this is a part of Italian and Italian-American history. I mean, factually, the story of what happened at Triangle, the story of the needle trades in New York City, is a story that implicates Italians. There were lots of Italians, women who worked in the needle trades, who worked at Triangle. And a third of the 146 people who died that day were Italians, some of them in the U.S. for just about a year. So they were really, many of them, I'm sure their primary identification was not here, it was there. And the youngest were 14, among them was one of the Maltese family. And even if they were 14, we don't know, right? We do know that sometimes young children lied about their age to be able to get the job that was so desperately needed in the factory, so maybe even younger than 14. But the Triangle story really doesn't have a lot of traction. It's not very well remembered here in the U.S. Now, if we're talking about labor history, it is. And we don't remember a lot of labor history. We don't teach it. It's not mandated everywhere. It is. I'm not sure if it's mandated in New York, but it's mandated in California, I know. But a lot of places it isn't. But if people do know anything about labor history in the U.S., they tend to know the story of Triangle. It's a very moving story. But they don't tend to know that it's a story that involves Italians.
So it is not part of our collective memory here. I mean our Italian Americans. It does have a large cultural presence in Italy, though. The celebration of 8 Marzo, International Women's Day, which really was inspired in part by the recognition of the struggles of women in the needle trades in New York and in the U.S., and as sort of much less important here than it is in Europe, Italy in particular, that observation is inspired by the story of Triangle. Many of the details are wrong. It wasn't an Anglo-American who owned the factory and was exploiting immigrants. Blank and Harris, the owners, were Jewish. According to one part of the legend, it's because there was a mimosa bush, and that was the very last thing that the girls saw before they died. Well, no, there wasn't one, and it didn't happen on March 8th. Nonetheless, it's still a very powerful, and it is still a very important part of Italian public memory. Not so much in the U.S., but that's changing, I think. One of the moments I think we can point to when it started to change was 2001, when a group of women in New York, led by Italian-Americans, but not only including Italian-Americans, got together for the 90th anniversary of the fire and observed it with some ceremony, and we had lectures and a procession. And it's that kind of memory activism is really, really continued to develop. So you've got wonderful things happening, like Annie Lanzalotto, who has written about and really done a lot to bring back the story of Josito, the hero of Triangle, was an Italian-American, a young boy who kept taking people down in the elevator until the cable collapsed and he could no longer do that. And you have Lulu Lolo, whose mom is interviewed in the film, who does a wonderful one-woman performance called Soliloquy for a Seamstress, and she's done it all over the place. And you've got Edvige Giunta, who teaches a course regularly at Jersey City University on the Triangle Fire. And you have me, who works, I'm now the chair of Remember the Triangle Fire Coalition, and am spearheading this project to build a memorial at the site of the fire. And Vijay and I are actually collaborating on a book of essays called Talking to the Girls, Intimate and Political Essays on the Triangle Fire, which is about how memory of Triangle has inspired academics, artists, activists, family members, not just Italians and Italian Americans, but all kinds. So I'm hoping that what happens is that when we continue to do these talks, we don't have people in the audience saying, which they often do and still do, wow, it's really interesting to hear that this is a story about Italians. I always thought it was a Jewish story. And it is, but it's also an Italian story. And I was drawn to the coalition. I will close with this. I was drawn to the coalition. Well, actually, before I say that, I will say that in Italy, on the subject of memorials, every Italian who died in the fire, and Josito, the hero, is named publicly on a plaque or on a sign, a street sign in Italy. That's not the case here, and I think it's a little sad that the names of the victims are seeable and readable 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in Italy, but not here where they actually died. But we're working to change that, as I said. And when people ask me how I started working with the coalition, it started becoming involved in this activism and doing all this public memory work, which is, as Fraser will tell you, it's the biggest thing I'm doing in my life, you know, professionally and as an activist. I tell them that my mom was a garment worker, and when I was growing up, she told me that about Triangle, and told me that she and all the other girls who worked in the factory, they knew that they were safe because of what had happened to the girls at Triangle. And people just assume that my mom is Italian, but she's Irish. And so my Irish mom in Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania, is the first person who told me about the Triangle Fire. So this is really a story that belongs to everyone, but it also really, in a special way, belongs to us, and I hope that we continue to tell it. Thanks.
When you say that the names are public in Italy, in numerous places.
Absolutely.
Yeah, like not just one or two, like no. 25? To a couple of dozen places, right?
Yeah.
Italy, where there are plaques that commemorate the tragedy
yes.
of, yeah,
yeah. Yeah. And the heroism of Josito.
Right.
Yeah. So, I mean, and people, I think, many of you maybe know that there's a She Built New York City. It's an initiative to commission a monument or a memorial to a woman or an episode in women's history in New York. And we met with the She Built New York City people a couple of weeks ago, because I will say, I'm just getting a little bit political here.
No, you're fine.
Okay, so Bill de Blasio, who came to the Triangle Centennial commemoration every year before he got elected to office, has not come once since he's been elected mayor. In fact, he hasn't even responded to the invitations. Andrew Cuomo has given us $1.5 million to fund the capital budget. So we have been pushing the mayor's office, given that they've got this big She Built New York City initiative, and given that de Blasio also often plays on his, you know, I love my Italian heritage, I'm an Italian. So we're trying to push to get them to recognize this project
and to help us out. What do you need? What does the project need? It needs $500,000.
We need $1.4 million.
$1.4?
Total. I mean, here's the thing. When you hear about budgets for memorials, you usually hear about how much it costs to build. So I'm talking we need another $1.4 million so that we can build it and it will be taken care of forever. That's the deal we have with NYU. In 2012, we signed an historic agreement. They've never let anyone, they own the building, NYU owns the building that you saw. It's now called the Brown Building. It was called, in a real cruel irony, the Ash Building when the fire happened. But it was bought by a Mr. Brown who renovated it and donated it to NYU. And they've had NYU faculty ask to build a memorial, and the faculty were turned down. The ILGW in the 90s commissioned a memorial for generally about the, you know, garment workers, but also touching on Triangle and the project. They chose an artist, and it never got off the ground. So we're closer than anyone's ever been in over a century. But we have to be prepared not only to build it, but then to take care of it forever. NYU said, we'll let you use our building, but that's it. Like, everything else has to come from you. So it's a very, it's probably better if I could show it to you, but, and I have to say, like, that's not a criticism of, like, oh, I wish we could do this, because these guys, the Calandra's been great. We've probably, I think I've spoken about the Triangle Memorial here, like, four times. One of the first meetings was here, so I have to add that, while de Blasio has not been supportive, Tamburri has. So the corner, you know where you saw the signage going up in the corner in 19th century buildings and early, you know, 20th century buildings had that signage? So if you, starting at the ninth floor, where at the corner of Washington and Green, where, you know, where those, that signage would have been in 1911, starting at the ninth floor, a metal ribbon comes down the building, and then at about 12 feet above the ground, it splits like this. And into that, and it starts at the ninth floor because that's where most of the workers die. It was 62 jumped from those windows, and most of the 146 were on the ninth floor. And it splits right here, and in that split, which Washington, and the Washington Place side and the Green Street Place side, the names of the people who died are stenciled into it. And I'm really thrilled to say that we're using a font that was developed by a woman typesetter to stencil the names. And so when you're far away, you see this thing dropping down from the side of the building, and you say, oh my goodness, what's that? And then you walk up close, and you look up, and you see, or you don't, you walk up close, and you see the structure, right? And then you come up even closer, and at waist height, at the corner of Washington and Green, are another set of panels. This part looks like a ribbon, and it goes like this, and then at waist height, at the corner, there are other metal panels, and they're polished and reflective, and you're drawn in, you look at those, and you see those names that have been stenciled reflected onto the bottom panels. And then also etched into there will be a narration of what happened on March 25th, 1911, so that you actually have to walk around Washington, then turn the corner onto Green to get the story, which means you see all the names. And Kevin Baker, a board member of ours, if you've ever read Dreamland or Paradise Alley, he's a historical fiction writer, just won a Guggenheim Award. He's written extraordinarily beautiful prose that will be on the monument.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anarchism. They are paying a penalty for a crime of murder that they didn't commit.
The Sacco and Vanzetti case becomes famous around the world, and the bombings of Wall Street and San Francisco are forgotten. Those responsible are never caught. Among the hundreds of thousands of Italian immigrants who arrive in America in the early 1900s are also industrial workers. Many of them moved from the factories of northern Italy to the industrial towns of the northeast of the United States. One of their largest communities develops in Paterson, New Jersey, center of the American silk industry.
Many of these silk workers were already involved in political and economic activities, strikes, demonstrations in Italy before they came here, so that they already had a political consciousness. And again, you can associate certain cities with specific ideologies. In the case of Biella in Piemonte, you had a strong anarchist influence. So they kind of reestablished that subculture in Paterson, New Jersey as well.
Paterson has 2,500 self-described anarchists, and some set out to change the existing political order. In 1900, textile worker Gaetano Bresci returns to Italy and kills King Umberto I. Another anarchist, Michele Angiolillo, kills Spanish Prime Minister Canovas. And a Polish anarchist kills the American president, William McKinley. Paterson, New Jersey comes to be known as the world capital of anarchism. The town is visited by all the major Italian anarchist leaders of the time, including Enrico Malatesta, Francesco Saverio Merlino, and Pietro Gori. The Italian language newspapers written and read by the immigrants show the presence of not only anarchists, but also a wide range of other leftist political groups.
The anarchists, the socialists, the syndicalists, the only real institution that the Soviet CV had in the United States was the press. Groups, particularly in major cities, their primary activity was publishing a newspaper. And from the 1890s to the Second World War, they published almost 100 newspapers.
Paterson, with its 800 factories, is one of the largest industrial centers in the United States. It has more than 200 silk mills, making it the largest silk-producing area in the world. Thousands of Italian textile workers find jobs here. Many of them learn their skills in the silk mills of northern Italy. Pietro and Maria Botto are among them. Today, their home is the Museum of the American Labor Movement.
Maria and Pietro Botto came from Biella, Italy, and settled in New Jersey. They were used to the mountains of Italy and saw an advertisement about Halden, New Jersey, where it was mountainous and was close to silk mills. So they bought a lot here in Halden and built their house in 1908. Pietro went out to work, and his income was not enough. So Maria decided to make this house into an inn. They lived on the first floor, and they had tenants who lived on the second floor. In addition to that, Pietro would bring home his co-workers every night, and she would prepare meals for them, and they would pay her a small sum of money to help supplement their income.
The Bottos are actively involved in the union movement, and their home becomes a gathering point for the Italian silk workers of Paterson.
Things went on that people just do not associate with immigrants. Concerts, lectures, educational organizations. There was a very rich immigrant life, a rich intellectual life, which existed at that time, in which the radicals were absolutely in the heart of this. They read books. Every newspaper, every radical newspaper, had a library associated with it. And they would sell pamphlets, they would sell books, not just political books. You see the great works of literature. Victor Hugo, Ibsen, Dostoevsky, books like this are being read by the Soviet CV. It's a kind of self-development of the human mind, because their belief was that the path to enrichment and human fulfillment was through development of the mind.
However, working conditions in the textile factories of Paterson are extremely hard.
These factories were rather large, and you would easily have as many as 100 or more looms in one gigantic room. And the level of noise was simply deafening. The conditions in the dye houses were even worse, because here you're dealing with very caustic chemicals. You had to put your hands in it, and your skin condition would be terrible. There's no heat, there's no ventilation, so the workers are breathing fumes.
These people were working 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, and if they didn't produce enough silk, they would be told to go in on a Sunday. And they said, if you do not come in on Sunday, do not come in on Monday. In other words, they were fired. Children were also working in the mills. The boys who had to repair the looms had to go on the looms barefoot, no shoes. They would have their toes cut off from the mechanism that would malfunction and just rip off a toe or a finger.
Strikes are frequent, and some, like the one led by Galeani in 1902, are violent. The strike in 1913 is the longest and is known as the Italian strike.
The owners of the mills tried to implement a speed-up system by putting four looms into the mills instead of only two for each weaver to work. They decided to walk out. And one by one, all of the other workers supported them and walked out of the mills. And before you know it, 25,000 people were on the streets of Paterson and closed down the silk industry for nearly 6 months.
When the strikers take to the streets of Paterson, the police crack down violently. The strikers are forced to gather in the nearby town of Halden, where Pietro and Maria Botto live.
The mayor in Halden was a socialist mayor and very sympathetic to the workers. And he said, you can come up to my town. My police force of one will not bother you. So lo and behold, 25,000 silk mill workers walked up to Halden, New Jersey, and had their meetings here at the Botto House.
The main supporter of the strike is a union, the IWW, Industrial Workers of the World. They are a revolutionary union. Their goal is to have workers control both the economy and the state. Unlike many unions of the time, they seek to bring together the immigrant workers who speak different languages. One of their strike leaders is the Italian Carlo Tresca.
Carlo Tresca was, without a doubt, the most important Italian radical in the United States. In fact, he was probably one of the most important radicals of any ethnic group. He was a newspaper owner and editor of three of his own newspapers, which was unprecedented. He was a major strike leader throughout the period from 1904, when he arrives in the United States, until after the First World War.
Like many other Italian anarchists, Carlo Tresca has escaped to America to avoid being imprisoned in Italy for his political activities.
He was an incredibly fearless man. His courage was admitted by everybody, even by people who didn't like him. During his days as a labor agitator, as a strike leader, he would do things that potentially could have got him killed. When a parade of strikers that he's leading are encountered by a huge contingent of local police, he's got this faccia-faccia confrontation with the police chief, and he smacks him in the face. Who does this?
He would go out onto the second floor balcony of the Botto House and speak to the thousands assembled in Italian. And it wasn't only the words that he was delivering, it was the passion behind those words that made them believe every single thing he said. They knew they needed to stick together for the cause.
The factories are idle for 6 months. The union strike fund is running out, and so is food. The strikers are forced to send their children to live in the homes of workers in other cities. In the end, the strikers, exhausted and defeated, go back to work. The IWW will never recover from this defeat. In the decades that follow, Tresca turns his militancy to fighting the influence of fascism among Italian Americans. The rise of Mussolini in Italy is a source of great pride for the Italian immigrants in the United States. But Tresca recognizes the dangers of fascism.
Through his newspaper, Il Martello, he is hammering away, Martellate, he is hammering away at the fascisti, against Mussolini in Italy, and against the rise of the fascist movement in the United States. The Italian government and the local fascisti were determined to get him and put him out of action one way or the other. The American government was a de facto ally of the fascists in their attempt to crush the anti-fascist Soviet Union. Tresca, who was furbo, was able to manage in such a way that they could never get enough information about him to deport him.
Tresca takes on not only fascist sympathizers in America, but also the communists for their support of Stalin's dictatorship. Over a lifetime of journalism and political militancy, Tresca makes many enemies, including the mafia. On the evening of January 11, 1943, he leaves his newspaper office near Union Square and walks home. He is shot by an assailant who has been waiting for him in the dark. Tresca dies instantly. Tresca's militancy and larger-than-life personality have made him a well-known figure in New York, and there are many theories about who was responsible for his killing. The newspapers follow the investigations avidly. The police are convinced that the killer is Carmine Galante, a professional hitman, but the question of who hired him remains a mystery.
This became a cause célèbre. Who killed Carlo Tresca? It was almost as though, particularly in the Italian immigrant community, it was as though they realized what they had in this man who had fought for the interests of the Italian workers for decades.
Carlo Tresca's funeral in New York City is the occasion for a massive outpouring of grief. More than 5,000 mourners come to pay tribute.
Professor Fraser Ottanelli teaches at the University of South Florida, and most recent, the person on screen is the late Bernicone, and Fraser finished a project that is now co-author of a book, indeed, Assassins Against the Old Order, about Italian anarchists in the United States, and we will be, the book is out now, but we'll be presenting it after the new year. So stay tuned. If you're not on our listserv, make sure you get on it. Let me start with a sort of strange question. People, is it true that had Tresca known English better, he might have been a more popular figure? Or is that, people have always spoken about a language issue with some of the Italian anarchists in this country.
I actually think that although Tresca in his later years after World War I spoke mostly to, during his anti-fascist period, his audience increasingly was an English-speaking audience. It remained prevalently an Italian audience. But I think one of the characteristics of Italian-American radicalism is that it is, in fact, Italian-American. It is Italian. So that, in fact, the people he spoke to, the people he organized, the people he garnered most of his support from were Italian speakers. Mm-hmm. It changes later on. But clearly, his most successful activities were really with Italian speakers. So, I mean, there are plenty of stories about Tresca. He had quite a personality. The story that I always like telling or like thinking about is that he was really, there was something very histrionic about him. So somebody once said that at a funeral he always wanted to be the body because he wanted the attention always on him. He wanted to be the corpse. Maybe later on, but the years in which he really made a difference, which are the teens.
Were for the Italians.
Yeah, I mean, his audience was really essentially an audience of Italians. Mm-hmm. So, and can I add, I mean, I can, this kind of segue to what I wanted to say. What really strikes me about the documentary, and it kind of something that I thought a lot about, is the fact that, you know, Italians, I mean, there are 20 million Italians who emigrate between 1861 and 1940, and only about one-fourth come to the United States. And it makes sense for us to talk about Italian-American radicalism and Italian-American labor movement. The same is not true about France. It's not true about Argentina. It's not true about Belgium, Brazil, other places that saw massive Italian migration. Because by the teens, Italian immigrants to those countries were mostly, in one way or another, in different ways, of course, depending on countries, but were essentially part of nation-based labor movements. They didn't have Italian anarchist organizations or Italian unions or even Italian language locals in unions as they did in the United States with Local 89 and 48, the International Lady Garment Workers Union and the Amalgamated Clothing Workers. So in fact, there is something very, very, very American about the experience of labor and radicalism. And a lot has to do, I think, with the way in which Italian workers were socialized. And it's interesting, I thought about, in watching the film, I think it's very interesting that you start with the lynching in New Orleans. Because in fact, everywhere Italians went, worldwide in the 1880s and 1890s, they encountered violence. Actually, the worst case of violence against Italians was not in New Orleans, it was actually in Aigues-Mortes in the south of France, where we don't even know how many Italian workers were hunted down by French workers in the salt marshes around the city of Aigues-Mortes and killed, I think, in 1893. So it really was not the worst incident. So you have this kind of commonality of experiences worldwide for Italians. Yet, in most other countries, both in Latin America and Europe, maybe as a result of these acts of violence, Italians are progressively made part and brought in to dominant labor organizations and radical groups, building around the kind of a common class consciousness, a common, you know, commitment to, you know, to share revolutionary values in some cases. In the United States, that's not the case, except for the IWW, as is mentioned in the film. The AFL really keeps Italians at arm's length. And when they are allowed into the AFL, they're allowed into, as I mentioned earlier, through language locals. So they're kept mm-hmm. in this organization, but they have their own separate locals. So in fact, you do have the creation, which is very, very specific to the United States. You have this development of both, on the one hand, a class consciousness, but on the other, along similarly, at the a parallel structure or identity as hyphenated identity as Italians. So you kind of combine these two elements mm-hmm. of exploitation because of class and exploitation because of ethnicity. And that really goes a long way to explaining, well, a lot of different phenomena. I mean, you kind of understand, you look at the role of Italian-American syndicalists when they go back, people like Edmondo Rossoni, who is, the head of the Italian section of the IWW, who really embodies this sense of the Italian experience, exploited as workers and exploited as Italians. And when he goes back after World War I, he actually becomes the leader of the fascist labor movement. So he kind of combines this dual identity. But it also helps us understand the appeal of Mussolini in the United States in the 20s and 30s. It's not, I mean, these are the same Italians. They're not very different from the Italians who've gone to France or to Argentina. Yeah. But in those countries, clearly, Italian immigrants, as they become part of nationally based organizations with whom they share this class consciousness.
Let me ask you, how much do you think, you mentioned France, mm-hmm. for example, how much do you think that has to do with the fact that it is a quote-unquote romance-based culture? I mean, I'm thinking of like France and if whoever went to Spain, but also Latin America, of course, Argentina was. How easier was it to become part of, to use the term mainstream, how do you think easier it might have been in a place like Argentina or in a place like France, precisely because there was some sort of radical in the sense of root cause. There was some sort of radical similarity there.
Yeah, I don't think that's. I think the main element, the main difference, is the difference between the AFL and which was anti-immigrant, anti-socialist, anti-unskilled worker, and labor movements. In Latin America, which were actually formed by Italians, mm-hmm. created by Italian radicals in many cases, or in places like France, Belgium, Germany, and Switzerland, that had a very, very strong socialist component. And by their presence, Italians challenged this kind of working class nationalism that these countries, I mean, they would be internationalist in ideology, but not internationalist in practice. And then all of a sudden the Italians would show up and they would say, look, we want to join, we want to be with you. And they kind of force these movements to internationalize in practice as well. So I think really it is, if we want to talk about the process of hyphenation of Italian Americans, we really have to look at one of their major places of socialization in society, which is the workplace. And how they were received, how they were socialized, how they were brought into the labor movement or not. And I think in this sense, this is a very, very interesting part of the film because it does emphasize the Italian-American roots of labor and the Italian-American roots of radicalism, which would not make sense. I mean, makes sense in the U.S. context, but would not make sense in other receiving nations. Mm-hmm. And that's my spiel. I'm sorry we're wet. We went to the demonstration in front of Trump Tower and we got drenched. So that accounts for this look.
I'm sorry. Just to clarify, the marginalization of the Italian immigrant worker by the labor movement was not because of a racism against Italians so much as their low skill.
Well, I think the AFL is it's an organization that at the end of the 19th century organized 5% of the U.S. labor force and really worked on skilled workers. So you have the massive. So they were unskilled, they were radical, and they were foreign. So I mean, I think you can't really separate any one of these three. And when they are brought in reluctantly. They're done. They're brought in, and they are local 89, la locale 89 delle sartine, has 40,000 members, But it conducts all of its operation. Everything is conducted in Italian. So there really isn't the development. What you find, for instance, if you look at the CGT in France, by the 1930s, Italians are the largest ethnic group within the CGT, the main labor organization in France. But they're not organized in separate locals. They are, they're thrown in together with everybody else. So you do have a development of a broad class-based consciousness in the workplace that brings together workers of different backgrounds, united by their common shared experience and shared enemies. In the case of Italians in the United States, as the film points out so well, these two elements, the elements of oppression because of class and also because of ethnicity, coexist. So this kind of hyphenated identity is in many ways the product of I'm stretching it a little, but I think not too much. Really, is a product of how Italians, how immigrants were socialized or not by the labor movement in the United States.
First of all, I wonder if it has to do with how multi-ethnic are the societies that you just mentioned. In France, is that a multi-ethnic society back then? So I don't know. I'm asking because I definitely know that in Latin America there were active Italian anarchist groups. So that's the first thing. And then you mentioned it and you brought it up about the Italians, but it's true for pretty much the whole America. I mean, there were Yiddish papers for anarchists and Yiddish communists, but the Communist Party in the US had a Jewish section until literally the 80s. So it's part of the way that the organization was here. So number one, I don't know if France had that many immigrants from many different countries that would have created a situation like this one. And then it has to do probably also with the sheer numbers of people that emigrated to some of those countries. In both directions.
Mm-hmm. No, that's really a very, very good point. And in France, yes, it's clearly a multi-ethnic country already by the end of the 19th century, with massive migration from Belgium, Spain, later on Portugal and Armenia. I mean, in many ways not dissimilar to the United States. There's this wonderful work that has been done on probably the most successful resistance networks in Paris, the Manouchian network of 1943, which is really the, as we would say in Italian, the punta di diamante of the resistance in urban resistance in Paris in 1943, whose members then were all eventually discovered by the French police, turned over to the Nazis and executed. And the interesting thing is that we really have the biographies of all, there are about 30 members of the Manouchian group. The leader of the group was actually Armenian. All the others were Polish, Romanian, they were three or four Italians, Spanish. So it really gives you a sense of a broad kind of ethnic mosaic of people. In the case of Argentina, the irony is, of course, that the first radical and labor movement in Argentina is actually German. And they exclude the Argentinians and the Italians because they refer to them as pueblos románticos, right? They're these, they can't be taken seriously. But it is the arrival of Italian anarchists, Malatesta and others, who really turned the Argentinians, when they start publishing their newspapers, they publish them first in Italian, and then eventually they switch immediately to Spanish. So they're immediately very much conscious of the need to create a multi-ethnic, because it really is a reflection of their experience. What you say about the United States is true. You do have language organizations, the Socialist Party, the Communist Party, the unions, they're all organizing all these language-based organizations. And in many ways, it is not, Italian Americans are not the only one who hyphenate their identity. When you go to Argentina, you'll find, you'll find Jews or Argentinians of Jewish descent. Or in France, you'll find, French of Italian origin or Polish origin. But you don't have this hyphenated identity. It really is only a product of the United States. And this is something that I've actually written about, repeat something I said earlier. It really is a function of the process of socialization through class-based organizations.
Let me ask you about the overall theme of the documentary. Often, sometimes documentarians are accused of, you take the scholarship out there and you just sort of popularize it. But it seems to me that what you really need to do and what you are doing is bringing your own interpretation and your own historical research and analysis. And so I want you to maybe speak about that process in your.
We worked on this film for about 4 years, and so we talked to many scholars, and we tried to really choose some stories that gave a sense of the development of the immigrant experience of the Italians in the U.S. And we've started with the New Orleans lynching episode and went all the way to the Second World War. So it was difficult to follow, to have a thread, a chronological thread all through this. So we decided to divide it in chapters, and there are 10 separate chapters of this. It's been a challenge to try and convey, initially it was done for the Italian television, to an audience that knew very little about the development of the community in the U.S. And so we did a lot of interviews with scholars, but then we realized that it would have been too not very accessible. And so then we started doing interviews with members of the community. And what we saw in these chapters only have the scholars, mostly have the scholars in the interviews. But there are actually several chapters in which we have members of the community that talk about their experience of their grandparents. You remember in the case of the Triangle Fire, there's a whole family, the Maltese family, and we use that person to kind of illustrate the whole episode. I don't know, Suma may have some other.
Well, we certainly wanted to tell a story that kind of held together. I think, some of what Fraser and Marianne have talked to, the distinctness of the Italian experience was one that struck us and that we wanted to speak to. So starting from kind of the lynching, which is a very dramatic way of their marginalization. But that continues through World War II, and so we kind of go back to that over and over. And so there is a thread that continues. Also in talking about, it's a story that we wanted to tell.
At the cost of sounding naive, I think it would be interesting if the four of you would tell us, why do you think that so little is remembered of all this? I mean, why there is nothing in front of the triangle? Why it took so long? I mean, everybody can try to get some answers, but why the Italians have completely forgotten this stuff? I think it's sort of the underlying question of the evening. Why? I mean, we look at the political developments here, right. We understand very well, and Italy too, but I'm curious for your opinion about that.
Okay, that is, to me, a softball question with regard to the, and that's not a criticism of you, with regard to the Triangle Memorial. It's the U.S., it's an incident in labor history, and it involves women. So if this were 146 mostly guys who jumped out of a building and burned to death, we'd have 5, 6, 10, 20, we'd be swimming in memorials by now. So I will leave the rest of you to take the harder parts of the question, but mine was easy.
There are various reasons, and one is the political content of this. Whenever there is, the Italians, like all the other immigrants, were trying to integrate, to blend in, and it became quite obvious that they moved away from some leftist traditions that they may have had in Italy. And we see today where a lot of the community is politically. And So I think that the case of the Triangle Fire, it's I think the answer was very good. It covers all the bases. But regarding, in general, regarding the fact that Sacco and Vanzetti, for instance, have been created, have been rebuilt as kind of saints of the community, but their political ideology is not being really thought through. And I remember that one of the screenings that we had, there was somebody from the audience that waited for the end of the film and then came and kind of attacked me physically and said, how could you smear the memory of Sacco and Vanzetti, who were innocent workers? They were not anarchists. They were not political. You know, so some people have been, the political component has been washed away in a lot of places in the US, because the community perhaps felt, with the help of the Cold War and other processes earlier on, that in order to blend in, they better leave this part of their heritage. That's my step.
Can I just add something to that? It also was the left that contributed to that sanctifying of Sacco and Vanzetti. Because, and just to riff on the whole Cold War thing, it's a lot easier to sell them as anarchists if you, because you can characterize anarchism as this philosophical thing. So very often they're philosophical anarchists. And also, even by the end of the defense campaign, it was run primarily by liberals in the US. And when, you know, after the 1940, when there was this real split and the ACLU and anarchists and liberals, left-leaning liberals, were very prone to red baiting, and they gave in, they capitulated. And so it really served the interests not just of more conservative Americans, but also left-leaning liberals and anarchists to kind of minimize the radicalism of Sacco and Vanzetti, because they didn't want to be red baited.
I would also add that, reflecting both sides of the Atlantic, also in the case of the United States, I think in the context of the Cold War, it is much easier to think of, to emphasize Sacco and Vanzetti or even Tresca, because they are anarchists and Tresca becomes an anti-communist, than it is, for instance, to acknowledge that by the 1930s, probably the most active Italian-American radicals were actually communists. But, you know, it's easier to deal with socialist liberals and anarchists in that context than it is to, in the Cold War context, than it is to deal with communists. In terms of the problem with Italy, why what's going on is going on, I think there are two ways of looking at it. One is educational. You know, the fact that you actually don't, you know, essentially 25% of the population of Italy has migrated at some point. It is an integral part of our national history, yet it was really not. When I was, you know, a university student in Italy, where I got my laurea, immigration history was a field that was kind of an afterthought. You know, we really didn't talk about it. It was not in any way a component part of our national discussion when it came to historical affairs. That's kind of a simple answer. The real answer, I think, it's political. Clearly, the same language that we now see developing in Italy against immigrants, they're different from our people went abroad to work, these people are coming to use our resources, you know, take our resources, they don't want to work. Once they get here, they immediately go on welfare, they bring crime. I mean, you could have just shifted that to the 1890s or the early part of the 20th century, and the same language was related to Italians. All you have to do is follow the entire debate over immigration right now, and the language is exactly the same. Do we know, of course, that reality is very, very different? That immigrants, you know, what they bring, what they immigrants today, just like the immigrants of yesterday and before, what they contribute to our any nation is invaluable. Do we know? Do we have the numbers? Do we know that's true? Of course it is, but it's just they become simple, easy scapegoats for whatever problems the country is experiencing. And in this sense, why should Italians be any different than the xenophobes and the nativists of 100 years ago or of today in this country, in France, in Britain, and anywhere else? I mean, you know, unfortunately, we kind of, history shows that, you know, you kind of think you've defeated an enemy once in a major confrontation and that that problem won't arise again, and you find out that in fact it's you never win, and hopefully you'll never lose.
There are all sorts of analogs, I think, with that we can recall for in trying to answer the question why, and you know, it's uncanny, you mentioned then and now, and the similarities. It's uncanny the language you find in a series of articles written by a journalist named Eugenio Balzen in 1901, who for the Corriere della Sera followed Italian immigrants up into Northern Europe and then over to Canada. And then you see some of the language that's used with regard to the current immigration to Italy, and it just resonates. The old language resonates in the new, and the complaints resonate as well. You know, the question of why Italian Americans or Italians in America are where we are, which of course socially and financially for the most part are doing well, right? And people have gotten to places that are quote unquote powerful political places and so on and so forth. But there is a historical amnesia, and as a collective, I would submit that Italian Americans don't know their history. Why they don't know their history is something we need to get into, but they don't know their history. And that's basically, I think, a place to start. And they don't know Italy. They really don't know Italy. And so there's not just the language barrier with many, but there's also a sort of knowledge gap.
Having taught this stuff for a long time, as you have, yeah. I'm not always sure that, I mean, I've really come to the reluctant conclusion that it's that, you know, if people are enlightened, they'll see the problem with their ways and they'll change. I don't think that's possible. I mean, I don't think it is an issue of education. I mean, education helps, it creates the foundation, but I think there are clear political priorities that are established, and it serves a political process and a political purpose, and the victimization or the attack on immigrants, regardless of what evidence you provide, for some will always remain the same. They are responsible for everything. They're the easy scapegoat, just like anti-Semitism used to be, and probably still is. I think for some you're right. I think, you know, for some you can actually make this part of a national discourse and help out, help them understand. But there's a significant number of influential people in politics all over, in many industrialized countries, that really, there's nothing you can tell them or show them. This is really the easy way out. Because, you know, the alternative is advocating for significant social and economic changes, which they don't want to. They clearly don't want to embrace for obvious reasons.
Well, you're speaking to the dramatic paradigm shift of the last 15, 20 years that has gone on, right? And now it's called populism, which is a nice euphemism, but right, that, I mean, some of us are old enough to have, you know, grown up in the 60s and the 70s, and the language was different, and there was, no one used the word tolerance, you used the word acceptance, and right, and all of a sudden acceptance fell out the window. And people started using tolerance to the effect that we, you know, the Southern whatever for tolerance, and so
I agree, and it really hurts, you know, to go back home and to find out the place where I was raised in the last 3 years in a public space that they've killed 3 Senegalese.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, in public space, and you know, I kind of had the sense of Well, yes, but also, you know, I felt that where I was from, things like that would happen. And in fact, you know, as you well know,
Piazza Lavazza and
Ponte Vespucci, they shot three people. Three men who were from, you know, Senegal. So you want to hit somebody.
Please join me in thanking our panelists and our filmmakers.